The restoration of the monarchy had obviously not been welcomed by everyone. In the southwest, especially, Puritan religious feeling remained strong and suspicious, especially with a Roman Catholic king. Charles II had an illegitimate son, the Duke of Monmouth, who was a Protestant. Rumours began to spread that he was actually legitimate, the true heir to the throne. Monmouth came over from the Low Countries and began a rising in the southwest, where he was proclaimed King Monmouth. The rebellion was crushed. James, determined to make an example of the rebels, ordered the arrest and punishment of everyone involved. At each centre, Dorchester, Taunton, Exeter, Bristol, Wells, people were rounded up for a special court known as the Bloody Assize, punishing not just rebels, but anyone who was accused of even helping the wounded. Around 230 people were executed, some hanged, drawn, and quartered, and about 850 were sent to labor in the West Indies for 10 years. And many more, of course, were fined and had property confiscated. And James did not disband the army that had been formed to put down the rebels. England had a standing army again, just as it had under Cromwell. And he appointed Roman Catholic officers to run it. People began to murmur. And when the House of Lords expressed discontent, he dissolved Parliament. And as he continued to appoint Roman Catholics to public and church offices, public support began to ebb away from him. At his instigation, for instance, all the fellows of Magdalen College, Oxford, were dismissed and the college was turned into a Catholic seminary. James had two daughters, who were both Protestants. The elder girl, Mary, was married to William of Orange, ruler of the Dutch, a Protestant head of state. The heir to the throne would reverse James's whole policy. But early in 1688, James's queen gave birth to a son who would be raised as a Catholic. This was, he thought, excellent news. It made him more secure. He was wrong. It sealed his fate. Well, that and the fact that he seemed to be preparing for a joint war with Catholic France against the Protestant Dutch. And now it became evident that the Civil War really had changed the place of the king in England. He ruled by permission of Parliament, and Parliament wasn't going to put up with this one. A group of leading members of Parliament sent a secret invitation to William of Orange to save the country from a Catholic takeover by bringing them military assistance. William brought over a fleet carrying a large professional army. James tried to block it with his own fleet, but the winds were against him, and William landed unopposed in November 1688 at Tor Bay. The West Country had its own score to settle with James. And James simply panicked. The army wasn't behind him. Parliament wasn't. London wasn't. He was going the same way as Tumbledown Dick. In the middle of the night, he scurried out of Whitehall Palace by a secret passage. He got down to Sheerness, throwing the Great Seal into the Thames on the way. Ha! That'll fox him! It didn't fox anyone. He was captured by local fishermen. Eventually, William gave him permission to go to France. And no one had the faintest idea what to do next. William hadn't come to depose James, but to give military backing to Parliament in their quarrel with him. James had quite obviously quit, abdicated, gone, taking his son with him.